Good morning. Welcome to worship on this fourth Sunday after Epiphany as we celebrate this day that the Lord has made. A couple of important things are happening today besides us gathering for worship. We are hosting our mid-year congregational meeting today at 11:15. So if you are here in the building, you can come to the worship space for that. Or if you're at home, there's a Zoom link in your email that you can come on Zoom. And welcome to hear what's been happening and what will be happening in the upcoming year. Also, in between the worship service and the meeting today, please either, if you're at home, make a Valentine at home. If you're here in the worship space, go to the fellowship hall and make a Valentine. We are hoping to have enough Valentines for all of the 150 or so residents for Alden Poplar Creek by Valentine's Day. So I welcome you to participate in that activity sponsored by the Board of Evangelism. Also looking forward to next week, we have a special treat. Pastor Leslie Hunter from Holy Family Ministries is going to come and be our guest preacher. And so that will be something to celebrate. I hope that you'll be here in the worship center or online celebrating as we welcome him as our guest. We in the Lutheran tradition recognize many ways to embody reverence. And so as we begin our worship, I invite you to stand or embody reverence in the way that is most comfortable for you. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who creates us, redeems us, and calls us by name. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you and your beloved children. We have turned our faces away from your glory when it did not appear as we expected. We have rejected your word when it made us confront ourselves. We have failed to show hospitality to those you called us to welcome. Accept our repentance for the things we have done and the things we have left undone. For the sake of Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us and lead us, that we may bathe in the glory of your Son, born among us, and reflect your love for all creation. Amen. Rejoice in this good news. In Christ Jesus, your sins are forgiven. You are descendants of the Most High, adopted into the household of Christ, and inheritors of eternal life. Live as freed and forgiven children of God. Amen.
Thank you. God like Jehovah. There's no 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 God like Jehovah. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. Lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. Lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you. Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The first reading for this fourth Sunday of Epiphany is found in Jeremiah 1. Now the word of the Lord came to me saying, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations." Then I said, "Ah, Lord God, truly I do not know how to speak, for I am only a boy." But the Lord said to me, "Do not say, 'I am only a boy,' for you shall go to all whom I send you, and you shall speak whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord." Then the Lord put out his hand and touched my mouth. And the Lord said to me, "Now I have put my words in your mouth. See, today I appoint you over all nations and over kingdoms, to pluck up and to pull down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant." Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. The second reading is from 1 Corinthians, the 13th chapter. If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. But as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now faith, hope, and love abide, these three, and the greatest of these is love. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
Chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Then Jesus began to say to all in the synagogue in Nazareth, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his mouth. They said, "Is this not Joseph's son?" He said to them, "Doubtless, you will quote to me this proverb, 'Doctor, cure yourself.' And you will say, 'Do here also in your hometown the things that we have heard you did at Capernaum.' And he said, 'Truly, I tell you, no prophet is accepted in the prophet's hometown. But the truth is, there were many widows in at the time of Elijah, when the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months, and there was severe famine over all the land. Yet Elijah was sent to none, except to a widow at Zarephath in Sidon. There were also many lepers in Israel at the time of the prophet Elisha, and none of them was cleansed, except Naaman the Syrian. When they heard this, all in the synagogue were filled with rage. They got up, drove him out of the town, and led him to the brow of the cliff on which their town was built, so that they might hurl him off the cliff. But he passed through the midst of them and went on his way. Holy wisdom, holy word, praise
to you, O Christ.
Just to catch us up, to make sure that we are all on the same page of the story. This story from the Gospel of Luke comes directly after the story we heard last week, where Jesus had been traveling and he comes back to his hometown and goes, as was his custom, to the synagogue. And while he is there, he is invited to speak and unrolls the scroll of Isaiah, and he turns to a passage that tells the people that the day of the Lord's favor is coming. Then Jesus says to the people, "This scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." That is where we pick up the story today. Having heard that the day of the Lord's coming is here, people would have been expecting that the blind would see and the lame would walk, that those who were imprisoned would be set free, that the oppressed would be raised up, and that the mighty would be knocked down. Think about what good news that is. As we gather together today, many of us are tired or weary. Many of us seek a word of good news or freedom. Each of us come looking for God in this place, hoping to find a community that will bring healing and hope and a future for us. Imagine hearing those words. That future is coming and is here today. And then immediately after, hearing these words, but not for you. That future is for somebody else. That future is here for those who aren't gathered today, but for those who have no idea what we're doing here, or could care less. God's future is coming and is here, and that good news is not meant for you. I can imagine that I too would be pretty upset, maybe disappointed, but our text says that those in the synagogue were filled with rage. What do you mean that gathering here doesn't make a difference for me? What do you mean that this God whom I have worshipped and prioritized in my life is coming to set somebody else free? What indeed does this mean? It could be that Jesus is saying, well, you all are those who are the oppressed. Or are the oppressor, and God is coming for the oppressed. It could be that Jesus is saying, you all are the ones who are rich, and God is coming to bring good news for the poor. It could be that Jesus is saying,
This news was never meant for you, this community. It was always meant for somebody else. Of course, it could also mean that Jesus is saying, this good news is already present here, and somebody else needs to hear it. Could be that Jesus is saying that God's freedom is already here in this community. Look around you. Now let's share it with somebody else. It could be that Jesus is saying, the future that is promised to you and is present is all around and within you, and you just haven't noticed yet. Or haven't taken the time to step into that future and see that something different is already happening here. I suspect that those hearing Jesus would hear that message in a little bit different way. It might still bring anger, and it might still bring confusion. But what if we looked around and saw within us, within this community, that those who are poor are lifted up, that those whom society deems are lowly are the ones that we listen to and prioritize? What if in this community we notice that God is more present when we are gathered together, and that everyone is welcome at the table, and every person is invited to share their gifts, and when they don't know what those gifts are, someone here points them out, lifts them up, and invites them to live into who God has created them to be? What if, when we say and hear that this prophecy has been fulfilled in our hearing, it is because God is already present, changing us and forming us into a community that is unlike anything else you can find in the rest of the world? The story that we hear from Paul's letter to the Corinthians is a story written to a community that was not representing this community of God, this kingdom that might be present among us. This conflicted community was struggling over who is welcome and who is not. They were struggling over how to name what each other's gifts are, and raising up some while denying others. This was a community where not everyone was welcome at the table, even though they said all are welcome, because there were some who could never make it to the table. It was into that community that Paul wrote this letter about how we are to be when the day of the Lord's favor comes and is fulfilled in our hearing. We will love one another. And that love is not a feeling. It's not an emotion. It's not something that we have today and is gone tomorrow. That love is an action. It's something we work on every moment of every day. It's something that we must set an intention to do. Love is patient. Patience isn't an emotion that I generally feel, but patience is a practice that I practice every moment of my life. Many of us feel an urgency to get things done, to make sure that we're meeting our benchmarks.
Many of us feel an urgency to move out of what was past and into some future. But patience calls us to rest and listen and wait and see what is becoming. Love is kind. Kindness is not an emotion that I always feel, especially when I'm impatient or when I'm angry or confused. Kindness is a practice that I must step into every moment of my life. Kindness is an invitation to see in somebody else the image of God, no matter how they're treating me, no matter what they are doing. Love is not envious. Love is not an emotion. Humbleness is not an emotion, but a practice that I must step into every moment of every day. And when I do that, when I live in humility, I recognize in others that might be less than me the gifts that God has given them. And my humility enables me to lift them up and send them forward. When I live in humility, it doesn't matter so much whether the promise is for me, because it is more than enough that it is true for someone else. This is the love that Jesus invited those in the synagogue to experience, to live in, to practice. This is the love that Jesus invites us to experience, to live in, and to practice. As we gather in community, to look for and notice and lift up how the words of the Lord are coming true in this moment for us. When we come together, whether in person or online, whether in this moment or later in a live stream, that we know that God is here with us, joining us together into a community that is unlike anything else the world has to offer. And so in this moment, may we choose to live in love. May we choose to be a community that cares about whose presence and whose voices we hear and who can't speak, who cares about lifting up those whom society has deemed not good enough, who cares about putting the voices, the ideas, and the dreams of our children first. May we be a community that notices that even when we say all are welcome, all are not actually present. May we be a community willing to live in humility and understand what stumbling blocks we put in front of somebody else, so that all might know this good news. May we be and be continuously becoming a community that knows that the day of the Lord is near and has come. And may we be a community that can rejoice when that day is not meant for us, but for those who are not here, who are not present, to whom we might take that message of love and of life. May we together become a community that might love instead of rage, that might invite life instead of be willing to push Jesus off the cliff, that might be willing to become who God is calling us to become, and to be in this moment who God is calling us to be, and to live each moment in love, like that love Jesus has for us. Amen. So let us pray. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe. You made the whole earth for your glory. All creation praises you. We lift our voices to join the songs of heaven and earth, of things seen and unseen. You stretched out the heavens like a tent. You divided the day from night. You appointed times and seasons for work and rest, for tearing down and building up. You blessed your people through all generations and guided them in life and death. Abraham and Sarah, Moses and Miriam, Isaiah and all the prophets, Mary, mother of our Lord, Peter, James, John, and all the apostles, and all the saints and witnesses in your church of ages past, in whom your spirit spoke and moved. We give you thanks, O God, as we dedicate these candle lighters to your glory and praise. You gave light to the world to cast away shadows. Let your presence be so effective that wherever these bring light, they may also cast away fear. And when they snuff candles, may we be reminded to carry your brightness within us to all the world. Grant us faith to know your gracious purpose in all things. Give us joy in them and lead us to the building up of your kingdom.
through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Let us join together now in confessing our faith in the words of the
Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Spirit of the Lord is poured out upon us in abundance, so we are bold to pray for the church, the world, and all that God has made. Guide your church in the ways of faith, hope, and love. Cultivate ministries and communities of compassion that bear witness to your enduring presence among us. God of grace, hear our prayer. Teach us to live in humility on the earth. Curb arrogance that leads to the destruction of natural resources and disregard for future generations. Inspire the work of scientists who urge us to live in harmony with your creation. God of grace, hear our prayer. You are the refuge of all who seek hope and freedom. Accompany immigrants, refugees, and asylum seekers who cross borders to find safety and opportunity. Embolden leaders to draft compassionate policies on behalf of migrants and those who assist them. God of grace, hear our prayer. Love bears, believes, hopes, and endures all things. Comfort with your love all who are lonely, fearful, or brokenhearted. Sustain the hope of all those who suffer in body or spirit, especially those whose names we speak aloud or hold in our hearts at this time. God of grace, hear our prayer. Your grace falls upon young and old alike. Bless the gifts of children in this congregation and in this community. Give us humble hearts to follow their leadership. Inspire us with their laughter, their insight, and their curiosity. God of grace, hear our prayer. As our congregation meets today to celebrate our ministry through you, inspire and guide us. Grant us courage, hope, and joy as we seek to follow you. God of grace, we praise you for those who have gone before us and now see you face to face. Abide with us in this mortal life until we rest in the arms of your never-ending love. God of grace, hear our prayer. Since we have such great hope in your promises, O God, we lift these and all our prayers to you in confidence and faith. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let's share a sign of Jesus' peace with one another.
are you, O God?
Sovereign of the universe,
you offer us new beginnings.
And guide us on our journey. Lead us to your table. Nourish us with this heavenly food. And prepare us to carry your love to a hungry world. In the name of Christ our light. Amen.
This is the moment to, if you are present in the worship center, to make sure that you have your communion set. And if you don't, you can raise your hand and an usher will bring one to you. And if you are worshiping at home, to make sure you have bread and drink that will become for us the body and blood of Christ. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. By the leading of a star, he was shown forth to all nations. In the waters of the Jordan, you proclaimed him your beloved son. And in the miracle of water turned to wine, he revealed your glory. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this to the remembrance of me." And then again after supper, he took the cup, blessed it, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. This is the feast where all of God's children are welcome. Come and eat, be fed, and be healed.
Lord.
together, you take the bread, hear these words. This is the body of Christ given for you. And as we drink, this is the blood of Christ shed for you. I invite you to stand or embody reverence in the way of your choice for the communion blessing. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the gifts of Jesus' body and blood strengthen, keep, and unite us in God's grace today and forever. Amen.
Let us pray. We give you thanks, gracious God, for we have feasted on the abundance of your house. Send us to bring good news and to proclaim your favor to all. Strengthen with the richness of your grace in your Son, Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
Now receive the blessing. God, who leads you in pathways of righteousness, who rejoices over you, and who calls you by name, bless your going out and your coming in, today and forever. Amen.
Go with Christ into a weary world. Share the good news. Thanks be to God.